Securities lending industry is becoming ever more complex. How are market participants reacting to the change? And what does the future hold for alternative trade setups, such as with a CCP or under a pledge structure? Let's hear what our experts think about these issues and more.
Back to the gold hall, and for our first breakout session dedicated to securities lending. This breakout will talk about the major themes in securities lending today and how the industry is reshaping, and even more interestingly, the opportunities and the challenges ahead of us. Today we have a terrific panel representing all the different communities of the securities lending world. We have a borrower, we have a principal lender and borrower, an agency lender, and a buy-side lender. And the session will be moderated by Mark Hutchings from ISLA, and it will be accompanied by David Brand from Morgan Stanley, Mick Chadwick from Aviva Investors, Valentina Crovato from BNP Paribas Securities Services, and Uli von Berg from ZKB. Just one point is we're missing Jonathan Lombardo. Unfortunately, he couldn't come to our event today for a big issue he had on his neighborhood, but thanks God he and his family are fine. But he sends his apologies for not being able to join us today. So now, ladies and gentlemen, all yours.
Great, thank you very much, Olivier. Good afternoon, everyone. And firstly, let me, on behalf of all of us, thank Euroclear for inviting us to speak here this afternoon. We've got an excellent group here assembled from, as Olivier said, from all sides of the business. Obviously, we are missing Jonathan, and he sends his sincere apologies for being unable to make it here today. The topic is titled Securities Lending in a Changing World. A very broad topic, obviously, and in the next 45 minutes, we'll do our best to try and cover a whole lot of ground. We obviously would welcome questions from the audience, so you have the polling app, so please, sorry, the app, so please submit your questions, and we'll ask those as we answer those as we go through. To just say a few introductory comments. Over the past couple of weeks, we've seen comments from both the Commission and IOSCO, which said that Europe's at the end of the post-crisis regulatory agenda, and it's now about implementation of regulations like MiFID II and SFTR. Where does the industry go from here, and what will transparency and reporting bring to the industry? We obviously have regulations, alternative ways to do business. Can't have a session without talking about Brexit in some way, shape, or form. And also there's the adoption of technology and even artificial intelligence. So we start with, before I ask the panelists to introduce themselves and we get into the discussions, I'd like to run through a few questions to help us, certainly, and hopefully you understand a bit more about your thinking and obviously the makeup of the audience we have in front of us. So if we could start with the first question, please. If you can please indicate if you're mainly a lender, agent or principal, a borrower, an institution beneficial owner, a service provider, or other. Please vote now. Okay. All right, that's a very, very interesting mix, which probably we would have expected, I guess. Okay, if we could go to the second question, please. So which product is at the core of your business today? Number one, securities lending, two, repo, or three, cash financing? The poll is now open. Okay. So securities lending is only 25%. They're really interested in this panel. That's great. Okay, thank you. So could we go to the third question, please? Which of these topics that we plan to discuss today is of most interest to you? Number one, pledge. Two, CCP. Three, collateral management. And four, regulations. And the poll is open. Okay, 50% interested in collateral management. That's great.
They're all the guys from Euroclear, right?
Absolutely. All right, that's great. Thank you. And then finally, if we can go to the fourth one. Which of the following binding constraints or regulations will impact your business most in 2018? Number one, MiFID II. Number two, SFTR. Three, Basel III. Four, German tax reform. And five, any others? Okay, thank you. Thanks everyone for that. Okay, so if I could start, what I'd like to do is to get a few thoughts from each of the panelists on pointing to this this specific one. What are the sort of implications that you see affecting your business over the next 12 months? And what impacts, what steps are being taken to address them? And maybe putting that more simply, you know, what are the binding constraints you're faced with, and you know, what are you doing to manage to those? David, could I start with you, please?
Thanks. My name's David Brand, and I work for Morgan Stanley. over the last year, we've really predominantly been focused in terms of priorities. NSFR for us has been the kind of overriding constraint that we've been mapping to. And then kind of second to that really is quite a significant body of work around what we're going to do post-Brexit. So moving people, more people into Europe, those two things really.
Mick, do you want to continue?
Yeah, hi. Mick Chadwick, Head of Securities Finance for Aviva Investors. MiFID is an interesting one, given that the title of this panel is Securities Lending, because I think the securities lending industry was a little bit confused about the extent to which MiFID really impacted them. But the closer you get to the deadline, the more you realize it does. Obviously, we're an asset manager, so MiFID and MiFID compliance kind of runs through our veins already. But I think some of our other lenders have had a fair bit of wood to chop this year. I think looking ahead to next year, though, a lot of the heavy lifting and a lot of the resource consumption is going to be around SFTR, particularly the trade reporting obligation.
Okay.
Hi, good afternoon. Valentina Cravato from BNP Paribas Securities Services. Very similar situations to Mix. So we've focused our efforts this year with on MiFID II, but SFTR is going to be our main focus next year. So whatever resources we had allocated to one project are just going to be moved on to the next.
Anoli.
Hi, my name is Julie Van Berg. I'm working for Sergi Cantonal Bank. And our focus is, at the moment, less the SFTR topic, because Switzerland is not in the EU. so we don't really have this at this point. It's more like the Swiss market. If you look at the Swiss market, for me, myself, it's like a sleeping giant. You have a market size of 5.8 trillion of assets sitting in Switzerland in bank accounts. But of them, you only have 140 billion on loan. So that's roughly 2%. If you then take the ISLA statistic of an average on loan quote, should be around 12 to maybe 13%. So there is some potential there.
Okay, great. So you, clearly you're going to spend a lot of time trying to release those resources. What sort of things are you doing to try and do that?
We actually started already with ISLA as well. We were listening to the market. The market is very reluctant when it comes down to the buy side. We hear statements like, well, if everyone would do securities lending, the whole market would collapse. Interesting. We hear statements that there should be best practice standards in the securities lending world. Well, there are. So we, after listening to them again, we actually tried to go out there and get a market standard contract for the buy side, which is not there yet, with less complexity. And we also tried to get, we have not talked about this in the ISLA board, but we tried to get a label or a certification to tell the clients that they are aware that their service provider is a member of ISLA, they are adhering to the money market code from the Bank of England, and they are used to live with the best practice standards. So that's what we're trying to do.
Okay, thanks, Early. I mean, one of the things that we clearly hear about is, you know, we talk about binding constraints, and clearly a lot of work is being done on MiFID II. You know, we've got 40% of the audience feel that's a major impact next year. You mentioned it, the big time suck. How do you decide where to spend your scarce resources these days?
Well, I mean, yeah, I think in common with every institution, anything that is a regulatory requirement automatically goes to the top of the pile. You know, the good news is, I would say that, you know, echoing what you were saying before about the feedback from people like IOSCO, is I don't think there's any major new regulatory initiative currently in gestation. You know, the bad news is what's already out there will probably take at least another year or two to be implemented and probably embedded. In terms of prioritizing resources, yeah, every institution in the industry has some sort of capacity constraint. Looking at, for example, SFTR, I know there's a lot of people done a lot of work already about speccing out reporting engines and what the business model should look like on that side. From our perspective, we've been relatively unable to engage with that because so much of our efforts have been focused on MiFID during 2017. Now, hopefully during the course of this quarter, a few of these MiFID deliverables actually land, and then that frees us up, and then SFTR is the kind of the big project for next year.
Do you find that the same?
Yeah, Valentina? Absolutely.
I mean, one of the things that we've sort of probably brings us on nicely is looking at post-regulatory world. We clearly know that the regulations have driven a lot of where we're going with new routes to market or potential alternatives. David, you know, it's well known that your firm has been keen on developing the CCP route. Can you expand a bit on that for the audience? Where that's come from and why
yeah, I mean,
you're focused so much on that?
I'll try not to bore everyone in the room, but basically, we're one of 8 G-SIBs in the States. We carry an extra 2% on our leverage ratio on our enhanced SLR, which makes low-margin wholesale business like repo and securities lending very difficult for us to manage and also to make our return targets along with the rest of the firm. So how do we get a 2 or 3% ROE business like the repo business? How do we get that to a 10% ROE business? Well, we don't stand alone. And so on its own, with no other client impact, we probably choose not to do some of the business that we do affect at the moment. So kind of finding solutions for us to maintain our client footprint now is of key importance to us. So let's assume there's no change in our regulatory framework in the US. There's talk of that US Treasuries may be taken out of our enhanced SLR position for G-SIBs in the States. If that happens, then obviously that will have a positive impact for us, but let's assume it doesn't. How do we maintain our footprint long-term, given the current denominators that we need to fill in to that ratio? And having a CCP at our disposal is key for us in order to get some cross-netting across both repo and securities lending. That's of key importance to us. So it gives us that continued access to capacity. So it's going to be one lever. It's certainly not some pursuit where we're going to put everything into one basket, but our ability to use a CCP is key. Not only that, it's also going to be of a huge benefit to audience in the room. We're 100% risk-weighted counterparty for everybody in the room. So it's five times more expensive, ultimately it will be, for lenders to lend to Morgan Stanley over and above a bank. And that cost is going to trickle into the system. And CCPs are 2% risk-weighting, so it's 50 times cheaper, ultimately, to face MS through a CCP. So there's benefits to both sides. And I think, ultimately, we'll see some liquidity move there, and then it's about ensuring that we maintain our current footprint in the best way possible. And without other solutions, I think long-term, to be quite honest, Morgan Stanley will struggle to do that.
So it's quite clear this is, from my experience in talking to various players in the marketplace, this has been a sort of like evolving process. We know it's been evolving over many years, but are you starting to see traction now, David, people's liquidity coming in for you to access through a CCP?
Morgan Stanley's been saying we've seen positive traction for the last year and a half, and we're still not there yet. So obviously, I'll face Yuli on CCP, but you know, ultimately, the only activity ongoing at this moment in time is between banks. And there's a couple of lenders out there that everybody knows that have committed to being live. I don't think we'll see anything this year, but ultimately, I think by the end of Q1, you'll start seeing some liquidity flow through that platform. And I think at that point, it's down to other institutions to see what value there is there, what the pricing looks like. If liquidity starts moving there more swiftly than it currently has, then it's going to be an alternative solution for people, and it's going to manage exposure. So there's benefits all round. I think there's no desperate need to get it over the line now, but I think by the middle of next year, I'd like to see two or three clients active there, and I think that will then, as you know, most clients are of the opinion that we'll see. Why do we want to spend scarce resource now getting compliant, getting access to a CCP when really it's only been Morgan Stanley historically who's been really pushing this? And that makes no sense if you've got a number of different axes from different institutions. I think that's been the frustration for the majority of lenders, is that there's no consensus among the big borrowers as to what the most important issue or new trade solution that's required for the market.
And right.
If you had someone from Goldman Sachs up here, they'd have a very different story about what their priorities are than Morgan Stanley at the moment. So that's frustrating, but I think over time we'll just start seeing liquidity move to these new solutions.
Thanks, David. I mean, I'll open it up to obviously the guys. Do either of you want to jump in here?
Well, I mean, I think from a buy-side perspective, you have to start from the premise that the buy-side hates CCPs. And I'd say that even if Jonathan Lombardo was here. We don't get any netting benefit, you know.
But we do.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you for explaining that. But no, I mean, we understand the compelling logic for David's firm. From our perspective, if we could avoid making that choice, we would avoid it. But at the end of the day, you know, the securities lending is a borrower-driven business. We have to make ourselves as user-friendly and as attractive a source of supply as we can. The difference between 100% and 20% and 2%, you know, sounds compelling, and should over time feed through into conversations about price and also conversations about capacity. And, you know, we're having numerous conversations with sell-side counterparties and, you know, varying degrees of carrot and stick, respectively, in terms of what's in it for us. But what the borrowers have to appreciate is that from the perspective of the underlying beneficial owner, unlike, say, central clearing for OTC derivatives, which has been imposed by regulation, or unlike central clearing for repo, whereas if you look at something like the LDI business, repo is very much an intrinsic part of a portfolio's trading strategy. For the overwhelming majority of ultimate beneficial owners, securities lending is a discretionary, bolt-on, nice-to-have business at the margin. If you make it too complicated or too expensive, they always have an option, which is simply not to do it. So, you know, we are engaged with the various central clearing initiatives, but to David's point, you know, we have five different sell-side firms come in, and they'll have five different sets of priorities. Unless and until there's a bit of critical mass and a bit of traction within the industry, it's difficult for me to make a business case internally to prioritize an initiative such as SEC lending CCPs.
Well, yeah, do you feel, I mean, two lenders here, one principal, one agent. How do you feel about this business?
We haven't really gotten anywhere closer to being live with CCPs as we were 2 years ago. We seem to constantly talk about it, but again, we haven't had that critical mass of demand that is required to actually assign resources internally to look after at the project properly. Until we get to that point, we're probably just going to concentrate on other things.
Keep a watching brief.
Yes, pretty much.
Yeah. Anuli, I know that you're active in using CCP, but...
Yeah, I mean, CCP is kind of a puzzle item for us, right? The Swiss market is predominantly a principal market, so I don't know if you know about the transformation possibilities we can have. We can turn around and give risk transformation on the collateral. So if the client just wants to have G7 bonds, we can turn around to the market and go out and accept equities and a broader range of collateral. We can go out and turn around on term, so we can provide term to our counterparties. And the market is one of these areas where we can actually, we don't need to do a big business case with our clients. We can do it on ourselves. So if it works for us, then we're just gonna do a project and do it. And since we were Eurex member on the repo side, it was easy for us to just set up also on the securities lending side. Yeah. So we're live and set up, and our benefits we see is actually the sourcing. So we would be happy to have more counterparties for the sourcing to source assets through the CCP that we can use for our internal market making team. The distribution, maybe there are counterparties we cannot face today, we would be able to face. Maybe even existing counterparties where we have limits that we've reached, so we can free up some of those limits and put them onto the CCP and kind of do more valuable trades for our clients with existing counterparties. Or in the end, but that's a little bit further down the road, it's also a risk mitigation case. So I want to have a CCP in my portfolio because at some point, if there's a stress situation, maybe I like to go to a CCP because your national bank and your CCPs are the ones that help you in a stress situation. So that's the last point.
Okay, great. I mean, that probably takes us nicely onto the other, another alternative route that's facing us these days, and that's pledge. Again, I'm going to pass it back to you as the borrower, David, but you know, maybe you could just give a couple of moments as to what sort of like is driving the demand for moving to a pledge structure.
Yeah, certainly. Well, it's certainly not us.
Can you talk for your...
Our nemesis down on Fleet Street are pushing this one, or have been pushing this one, and I think there are benefits to it, but really, from our perspective, the sole benefit is reducing our exposure and risk weight to certain institutions. It's not new for us, so we use pledge quite often when we're doing longer-term funding transactions with institutions where we have a particularly large exposure at any given time. That's one way for us to reduce our exposure by removing title transfer on the haircut and having that in a pledge structure. So I can see the benefit. It's kind of going back to we're pushing CCP as a solution because we are bound by other constraints to other institutions. But if you're bound by RWAs at this moment in time, it's a great way of reducing those.
But I mean, the interesting thing about pledge is that is one area where there does seem to be emerging a critical mass of institutions for whom it works. It solves some sort of capital problem, whether that's for the borrowers or whether that's for agent lenders providing indemnification. But there is enough interest in the pledge structure to justify the work that's now going on within ISLA, looking at coming up with some sort of industry standard pledge language. Because to your previous question, Mark, about bandwidth, what we faced with pledge historically was half a dozen institutions coming up with essentially the same proposal, but half a dozen different types of legal construction, which was definitely creating a bit of a bandwidth issue for our legal team. And, you know, full disclosure, the biggest single bottleneck in our institution is the legal function. You know, they're very good, but they're just snowed. And anecdotally, I suspect that's true of most firms. Pledge is not a panacea. Certain regulated fund structures, it doesn't necessarily work for. But it's useful to have it as another tool in the toolbox.
I mean, that's absolutely right. And obviously, ISLA has done a lot of work, and it might be worth me just, you know, just mentioning to where we currently are with the whole legal documentation work. So as Mick just said, we took we did a survey of all of our members and got critical mass to say, yes, we want you to put in place a standard market agreement. A standard market documentation is a lot easier for regulators to accept rather than lots of different bilateral documents. So we agreed and we appointed, as people know, Clifford Chance to work with us and a steering group to develop this documentation. Where we're currently at is we've got a GMSLA pledge version and a security agreement that has been reviewed by numerous counterparts, numerous members, and we've also got, we've worked with the tri-party agents, including, of course, Euroclear, to establish a account control agreement for this pledge structure. We're currently having discussions with those tri-party agents, and we're very much hoping that we will have finalized documents by the end of this year. I know that's not a long time to go, and you, to your point, it's the legal bit that takes the time for with their competing priorities, especially as we're going in towards the year end. So we are hopeful that there'll be some legal documents that we can have as final before the end of the year. I mean, I know you guys have looked at it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting, actually, because it's quite a similar situation to a CCP, but because we have had enough interest from the borrowers community, we were actually able to dedicate some resources internally to do some groundwork. So we did actually spend most of 2016 doing a bit of research on what were the drivers and how we would work in case of the event of default, and whether the tri-party agents were actually able to release the collateral in a timely fashion. We were satisfied with the answers that we got, but it's also so we were almost able to go out to our clients to suggest this as a structure, but we made the decision that actually we did need something from ISLA to present alongside our fundings. But it's a bit of a catch-22 as well, because as long as the pledge structure is recognized by the market, we do have something that we can present to the clients. However, there's only a limited number of clients that this structure will be really beneficial for, and the likes of clients with a non-netable jurisdiction will be the ones that benefit from a pledge structure. But until it's a well-established type of transaction, we will not be able to go to them to say, this is what the market is doing, this is what the market is recognizing as a as an entrance to the market. So we might not have enough of sort of critical evidence to bring to these clients to make them accept the pledge structure as a route to market.
Willie, I know we've talked long and hard about pledge. Maybe you can give us some thoughts about how it affects your business.
Maybe from a principal lender side, yeah. I mean, we're principal lenders, so we need the collateral to stay placed with us and give it back also to the lender we take the collateral from. So we cannot really live with a pledge, right? We are used to pledges when it comes down to OTC derivative collateral management, when it comes down to charges as well in Switzerland. So we still, when we got approached like over a year ago from a counterparty, or actually two, that asked us, could you maybe for the financing trades just, you know, help us on a pledge structure with the haircut? We were open because we thought that's going to be a binding, you know, a better relationship we're going to have with them. We're going to strengthen the relationship in general. So we tried to make it work. Our external legals, though, they did not get the answers they kind of wanted. And we felt that it's just too early at this point to really go out there and go with a pledge structure in the securities finance market. We actually got, you know, kicked back in a movie. I don't know if you know Castaway with Tom Hanks, where he was sitting on this island and he was actually building his own boat to try to enter the water. And that's what how we felt. And we didn't want to end up, you know, talking to the volleyball, Wilson, you know, and asking for the collateral in the end. So my actually legal specialist, that was Regula Berger back then, she was putting it to the point. She said, the pledge structure within the securities finance market is like if you're doing a surgery on your heart of the netting process. So it was just too early back then. I really like, and I need to get the curve here, what Isla is doing. We talked about this a lot, and I like, and we like it as a bank as well, if there is a market standard. And the most important thing, if the market standard is out there, across different jurisdictions, is really to have a waterproofed legal opinion on top of it. And then we're happy to also get into pledge structures with our counterparties, if that's going to work.
Okay, thank you, Uli. I'm conscious of time. We've got about 10 minutes to run. One of the questions said that collateral management was one of the topics that obviously, I think it was 50% of the audience are interested in. So just, I think we can spend a few minutes on that. So obviously collateral management is getting a lot of attention right now from regulators, specifically the ECB. They currently have a task force focusing on collateral management harmonization. Some of you may or may not know, but ISLA teamed up with ICMA to work on this. We have three excellent individuals helping members who are helping on the task force. And the idea of this task force is to promote common standards for collateral operations and their underlying trades. And between all markets, you know, that can happen if and only these players speak the same language on the same networks about the same things. In other words, we need a common set of messaging used on interoperable infrastructures and based on a common set of data. Now, you might all say that's, you know, hallelujah, but that's exactly what we're trying to, this task force is trying to bring about. Not necessarily on these that specific point, but I know we, you know, as in our preparation, we talked a lot about centralizing collateral management. And, you know, Uli, maybe you could just kick off, say a few points about that, what you've done in your organization.
Yeah, maybe on your point first. I mean, that market on the SEC lending and repo side, if you look at the middle office work they're doing, that market is screaming for some efficiency or some support on the system side. So I think that's a great thing to at least think about it, what you could do on that end. When I talked about the sleeping giant on the Swiss market, I now talk about the sleeping beauty that is awakening, kissed by the regulator on the collateral management side. Because we have the push on the OTC derivative collateral management is really important for us internally. Our team, our centralized team, is getting way more strategic and important within the bank. And on that end, we also not just waited for that regulatory move that mostly happened in September for us in Switzerland with FinFrock. We actually introduced a prime services unit. So that prime services unit is taking care of FXPB, client clearing, and also collateral management services for clients. So that took the whole collateral management unit from a cost center on actually to a profit center. And that was a big push with us internally due to the regulatory requirements and obligations we have.
That's interesting. I mean, I think a lot of this evolution is actually a cultural one. It kind of reminds me of the early days of the repo market when repo was regarded as a kind of quasi back office function. And I think you've got to be, it's interesting how the language evolves as well. I saw up before we came onto the stage something about the evolution of collateral trading. And collateral trading sounds like it's a front office discipline. whereas collateral management sounds it's more of an operational discipline. You call it collateral trading, you get a bit of front office focus, and to your point, you treat collateral as a profit center rather than just a cost center. I mean, in my world, you know, the traditional franchise was securities lending. We had to invest in a fair amount of infrastructure and expertise in collateral management just to support that traditional business. We're increasingly finding that we're being called upon to leverage that expertise and provide repo, reverse repo, collateral management solutions. That's the other thing as well. You've got to get the word solutions in your job description these days, right? We're the collateral solutions people for other internal stakeholders within Aviva Investors and also directly to our underlying clients. But it's important that the message lands that you're treating collateral and trading collateral as an asset class in its own right, as a front office discipline in its own right, rather than simply something that's being dragged along behind, you know, a proper front office product.
Valentina, anything? Probably finding the same sort of...
Yeah, same boat. But in particular, I think we've seen a couple of our counterparties lately who have centralized their collateral management into either one desk or even in some cases one individual person. That has made a huge difference for us, and we've seen balances increase, we've seen stable demand coming through, and this is exactly what our clients want.
David, I know that it's been a big push from your organization, but do you comment on that or more on the standardization?
This isn't new to us. So we combined all of those efforts and moved all of our funding requirements together and our clients' funding requirements together under one division and collateral management in 2008-09. And I'd like to say that was because we had great foresight, but it was probably because we were strongly encouraged to at that time. So we kind of had to do that. But we're still struggling with getting fully optimized. And we've got a dedicated team globally who are larger than our trading and sales force at this moment in time. So that gives you an understanding. They're part of the same division. So to your point, they're a front office mechanism. And the optimization work that they've done so far has been pretty seismic in terms of across derivatives platforms, across our commodities margining, across fixed income and equities altogether. And really, they're working every day, all day long, to try and ensure that in every obligation, the cheapest to deliver piece of collateral is given into that, whatever it may be at any given time. And that has its own headaches when you're using multiple tri-party collateral providers. And we'd love a bit more interoperability there. But there's a gentleman here, my colleague in New York, Edward Corral. He runs that collateral management business globally for Morgan Stanley. And he spends his entire time doing that with a large team of people. And without it, quite frankly, I don't think we'd be in the position that we are today as an institution, as a viable institution, without having that completely combined. And whether or not that's scrubbing down thousands of CSA agreements just to see exactly what was agreed back 10 years ago when we originally signed up to them, but just to make sure that any given time we're not leaving anything on the table in terms of delivering cheaper collateral for us.
Thank you. Obviously, few minutes to left, and before we sort of do some wrapping up here, as I said earlier, we shouldn't pass up the opportunity to touch on the favourite B word these days, and Brexit. You know, clearly we're sort of starting the process, certainly within ISLA, talking to people, what needs to be done, what should be done. David, what sort of are you guys, I know you made some comments at the our post-trade conference, your company is preparing. Can you share some of those thoughts?
Yeah, we've been pretty public around what we're going to do. We've been in Paris longer than we've been in London. So for us, we're already in Europe. We have a bank in Germany that we've had for over 20 years. So it will be a concerted move of people to Germany, to France, and some operations and investment management business over to Dublin. So that's already underway. We've taken some space in Germany, some additional space. We think we've got enough space in France, but it will be moving people to Europe.
So that's a relocation.
And two or three new European entities that obviously will cause some headaches around repapering. So there's definitely going to be some work that needs to be undertaken. when we're looking to borrow securities onshore on our German and French entities. So that may take some time. It's a headache more than a kind of a roadblock. It will take some time. But we're pretty comfortable in terms of we've already got kind of people in mind as to who we're going to move. That's kind of been approved, not fully, but it looks like we're kind of there. Our concerns are facing agent lenders in London, our London entity facing a London agent lender. At the moment, we're kind of comfortable facing off against an order placer that's a UK-based order placer, but then if there's some extra work done around giving up to a beneficial owner underneath that, it happens to be European, how do we passport that through? There's some kind of unknowns there at this moment in time. But as it stands, we're on course to move a number of people to Europe. It's not going to be hugely significant to the point that we shut London down, but there will be an influx of people into our existing offices in Europe.
Mick, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I mean, only to say, as I said previously, we're a borrower-driven business. So, we'll flex our lending program to be compatible with where we see the demand from. And to a certain extent, we've seen a bit of a forerunner of what might happen with Brexit more broadly with some of the initiatives with the UK banks and ring fencing. The good news is, as far as securities lending is concerned, the duration of any exposure, any transaction, tends to be relatively short term. So you can be reasonably flexible. If there's going to be some seismic change to the legal or regulatory landscape that forces us to completely reposition how we're configured vis-a-vis our underlying clients or the people that borrow, then we're in a better spot than some of our colleagues on the derivative side who've got a horrendously long dated back book that is going to require major surgery. So, and to David's point, we've got infrastructure and people and real estate within the EU27, but for us, I think it's more important what the borrowers do that will then dictate how we adapt.
Great. I think we've got one question.
Yeah, Mark. There is one question which is the following. No one has really spoken about the inevitable shift to proving transparency and best price execution. And the remark, the current bilateral markets are suffering from a lack of capacity versus a growing need for both collateral transformation and a wholesale shift away from unsecured and into secured markets. So I guess the underlying question is, what will really drive the securities lending market in 2018, and whether this need for collateral transformation and wholesale shift will drive that market?
Does anyone want to
take a stab at that
from
our perspective? Well, I think what the question is what's
major surgery? So, and to David's point, we've got infrastructure and people and real estate within the EU27, but for us, I think it's more important what the borrowers do that will then dictate how we adapt.
Great. I think we've got one question.
Yeah, Mark. There is one question which is the following. No one has really spoken about the inevitable shift to proving transparency and best price execution. And the remark, the current bilateral markets are suffering from a lack of capacity versus a growing need for both collateral transformation and a wholesale shift away from unsecured and into secured markets. So I guess the underlying question is, what will really drive the securities lending market in 2018, and whether this need for collateral transformation and wholesale shift will drive that market?
Does anyone want to
take a stab at that from our perspective? Well, I think what the question is what's happening to that liquidity in the front, or lack of liquidity very much in the front end, where banks are reducing their resources or balance sheet committed to the very, very short dated cash management business on a secured nature and on an unsecured nature. So we've definitely had that from most of our clients complaining as to why we don't want to take cash in a very short dated fashion from them. It's ultra low margin business, it's dead balance sheet that we give away, and ultimately we wouldn't be able to sustain the business we're in. But I think there's a there's several different providers out there now looking to bring a cash management tool that kind of disintermediates the banks, and I think largely that will be a success. So very short dated cash management needs will be provided by others outside of the traditional banks, and it will be real money accounts like Mix facing other types of real money names out there in the market. And I think very much in the short dates, there's going to be some credit work there that may need to go on. But I think by this time next year, you should see probably more liquidity going through those pipes than currently is. But the banks won't, given current constraints, the banks won't be able to sit in there and do the traditional deposit taking and cash taking as they used to.
Okay, thank you.
That's kind of what the question.
Thank you, David. We're out of time. Would like to have got a little bit more in. Obviously, it's a very broad topic, and we've got plenty we could have carried on talking for another 15, 20 minutes, probably another couple of hours. So I think at this point, I'd just like to thank all my panelists for joining today, and on to the next panel. Thank you.